Let us begin with what we discussed yesterday's lecture. We discussed that the consistency of electromagnetic theory and relative velocity expression required the presence of a special frame which was termed as ether. So this is what we discussed in detail, the concept of ether, which if both the things have to exist, coexist together, the electromagnetic theory and the old traditional relative velocity formula, then ether was a convenient way of having both of them live together. However, experiments did not provide support for the concept of ether. That's what we discussed in our last lecture. Then we talked about the postulates of special theory of relativity. These were the postulates of special theory of relativity, that laws of physics are same in all inertial frames of reference, and with a lot of argument yesterday we had on the semantics, I just removed it, ether does not exist. Now, we realize that we now require new approach. The old traditional approach will not work, especially the relative velocity addition formula by which we found out that velocity is C plus V or C minus V or C plus U or C minus U is not going to work. So probably we require a different formula which has to be consistent with the second postulate of special theory of relativity, which says that speed of light should be same in all frames. So this new formula is needed, which can ensure that speed of light is same in all inertial frames. Unfortunately, that's not just the enough thing. This formulation must also be consistent with the first postulate, which says that laws of physics should be same in all the inertial frames. So what we will discuss first is how the relative velocity formula has to be modified. Then we will discuss that that is not enough. You require something more in order that this particular thing, relative velocity formula, becomes consistent, or rather conservation laws become consistent with the first postulate, which is that all inertial frames of reference, you can apply all the physics laws. Okay. Now let us first discuss something what we call as a concept of transformation. I think all of us knows what is a transformation, but nevertheless, it's not a bad idea to formalize it, put into somewhat a formal language. If we have been given some information about any dynamical quantity in a given frame of reference, and if we need to know equivalent quantities in a different frame of reference, in another frame of reference, the set of equations that we are going to use are called transformation. I mean, as I had told you yesterday in the class, my experience, even with IIT students, is that when they solve mechanics problem, biggest confusion is about the frames of reference. People tend to confuse between the frames. Okay, I mean, standard question that you throw a ball in the train, okay, with reference to outside observer, it goes and goes up and comes like that. While with respect to inner person, it goes up and comes down. And people will use the idea of one frame and mix it with the idea of the another frame. So these are very, very simple things, but one thing which we always advise when people solve mechanics problem, you should fix your frame of reference. Now question is that I have fixed one frame of reference, but because of certain other reason, I am interested in finding out equivalent quantities in any other given frame of reference. Then I have to use certain equations to find out these particular quantities in another frame of reference. For example, a simple thing would be just, I know the coordinates of a particular particle at a given time in a frame of reference, and I want to find out equivalent coordinates at that particular time in another frame of reference. Or we find the velocity of a particular particle in a given frame of reference, and I want to find out the velocity of that particular particle in a different frame of reference. Or I know the momentum in a particular frame of reference, I want to find out the momentum of the particle in a different frame of reference. So the equations that we use to relate these two are called transformation equations. So there are various types of transformation. For example, there are coordinate transformation. We are just looking at the transformation of coordinates. The velocity transformation, which I just now told, that if you know the velocity components in a frame of reference, remember velocity is a vector, so we talk about the components. So if you know the velocity components in a frame of reference, I want to find out the velocity components in a different frame of reference, then the equation that I use is a transformation equation. Now, let us first, before we go to actual well-known Lorentz transformation, which is relativistically correct, okay, let us first go to the classical transformation, with which you are all familiar in the classical physics, so no relativity involved here, so that we just understand the transformation and then translate it over to the Lorentz transformation, which is the relativistically correct transformation. So I am formulating the problem. This is important to realize that all the equations that we are going to write is valid under these conditions. These conditions appear to be somewhat special, but actual, in a real sense, they are not really special, because, I mean, in principle, physics will not change. If you change a set of axes, or set a change of what you are calling the x-axis, start calling as a y-axis, or if you want to erect x-axis anywhere in the space, physics will not change. So why not choose a set of axes which are more convenient, more comfortable to deal with? And because relativity involves a lot of severe mathematics, so why not make our mathematics simple and use somewhat a simple concept? So what we say, that we take two frames of reference, two inertial frame of reference, which one we call as S, another we call S dash or S prime, as it is normally called. And we choose X and X prime axes in such a fashion. I mean, as I said, there is one particular frame of reference. Now, in principle, I can choose whatever x-axis I want. I have another frame of reference. There also, I can choose whatever x-axis I want. But I decide to choose x-axis such that the relative velocity is always in the x-direction. So this is what I am always assuming, that the relative velocity between the two frames is always along the x-direction. Suppose there is one frame which is moving, I mean, there is one particular frame here, another frame is moving like this, okay? So whatever is this particular direction, I choose my axis along that particular direction. It just makes our life a little simple as far as mathematics is concerned. We always assume that y and y prime axes are always parallel. It means y axis of S frame and y axis of S prime frame, they are always parallel to each other. Similarly, the z axis of S frame is always parallel with the z prime axis. This is what I have drawn here. So one is S frame, which I am calling as the red frame. Another is S prime frame, which I am calling as a blue frame, just to make it a little more attractive from the point of view of color. Okay. So S frame has x axis, y axis, and z axis. As you can see, x and x prime axes are always coinciding with each other. Y and y prime axes are parallel to each other. Z and Z prime axes are parallel to each other. As these two frames depart from each other, because there is a relative velocity between these two frames, or come together, okay, we assume that the velocity direction is always along the x direction. So the velocity direction is always in this particular fashion. And we are assuming it to be positive, so it means at a later time, this particular blue frame will move more towards the x-axis of the S frame. So these are the special choices of axes which we have taken, which by no means loses the generality, because as I said, x prime axes are always under our control. So we just decide that if I know I am taking a frame, there is another frame which is moving with respect to me, okay, I decide that whatever is the velocity direction, I will call that as my x-axis, and physics is not going to change if I choose a different x-axis. So this is what I am saying. There is another thing which we are, assumption which we are making, is that at a particular time, the origin O and O prime of the two frames would have been coincident. We assume that time is measured from that particular point of view. So time t is equal to 0 is when both the origins of the frames coincide. So O and O prime coincided at time t is equal to 0, when both the frames were exactly coincident, both the axes were actually coincident. So this is what I said. Frame S prime moves with respect to S along x axis with a velocity v. Of course, this will have velocity v will have only the x component, because we are assuming, that's what we are assuming. Clock of each observer, because there is an observer sitting in S frame, there is an observer which is sitting in S prime frame of reference, and both these observers synchronize their watch. They just put time t is equal to 0 when they pass at their origin. Clock of each observer is set to 0 when their origins coincide. So when the person sees that there is origin of other frame of reference, at that time he starts his watch. Similarly, that person, when that person finds that another frame of reference moving related to him, okay, when it's his origin, coincides with his origin, he starts the stopwatch. All right. So this is the way what we are assuming as a special choice of axes. This I will not derive. This is a very, very simple thing. This is what is called Galilean transformation, which is essentially a coordinate transformation of the classical transformation, which tells that the x coordinate of any observation, any event or any particular observation at a given time t, will be given by x prime is equal to x minus vt, because you can see very easily that this particular thing will be moving, the distance at a particular time t, distance between O and O prime will be v times t. So as far as x coordinate is concerned, that x coordinate will differ by vt. All right, suppose we have a particular point here. If I measure the x coordinate of this particular thing, x coordinate in S prime frame of reference will be this, while in S it will be like this. So basically x prime will be equal to x minus vt, while because y and y prime has to be same, z and z prime have to be same. So this is what is standard Galilean transformation, and we call it inverse transformation. It means the information that have been measured are measured in S prime frame of reference, and we want to find out the information in S frame. So we have S frame and we have S prime frame of reference. If the observations were made in S frame, and what we want to find out what an observer in S prime will make the observation, that is given by what we call as a direct transformation. If the observations were made in S prime frame of reference, then we want to know what are the equivalent observation in S frame of reference, then we will use what is called inverse transformation. Actually, in relativity, we always use the direct transformation and inverse transformation. They are always related to each other. In principle, even if you give one, this should be all right. All that you are doing, change prime to unprime, unprime to prime, and change the sign of V. That's the way we will always be able to go from any direct transformation to an inverse transformation. That's all it requires to do. Now, here there is one particular thing which is, we have written T prime is equal to T. This is something which normally in classical mechanics we never discuss. When we are taught Newton's law of motion, we have never talked about time. In fact, it appears that Newton has mentioned about time in his Principia. He assumes that time is something which is uniformly flowing across the system or something like that. He makes a statement. But generally, we always sort of ignore time. We always feel that whatever is the time measured in a frame of reference for any particular event, okay, let's fix our ideas. In relativity, it's always important to talk in terms of events. Something happens. Okay, if I make a measurement of the coordinate of a particle, this is what is an event. Okay, this event's coordinates I know. The same event's coordinate, event is an event. If there is an observation which has been made, this event will be observed by all the frames of reference. Okay. Now we find out the coordinates of that particular event in a given frame, and for the same event, we want to find out the coordinate in a different frame. So we generally talk in the language of event, which makes it comparatively simple. Otherwise, ideas get a little bit scattered. So in classical mechanics, we assume that if an event has occurred, if I have made an observation at a given time t, then according to another observer, that observation will also appear to be made at the same time t. Okay, so we sort of implicitly assumed t prime is equal to t, though we never talked about it. And this is the thing which Einstein objected. This particular last statement, that t prime is equal to t, is the one statement which we objected. How? We'll see. Now, it's easy to derive what we call as a classical velocity transformation. You just differentiate with respect to time. These coordinates, I will not go into the details, as we said, will not go into the mathematics. And you get a simple straight way, what we call as a relative velocity formula. This is nothing but relative velocity formula, that u x prime will be equal to ux minus v. So x coordinate of velocity will differ in the two frame of reference by v. The y component of the velocity and z component of the velocity will remain same. Remember, all these transformations are valid only with respect to that special choice of axes that we have taken. That's something which have to be kept in mind, because we have defined our axes, set of axes. We have defined how our time is going to be measured, how our coordinates are going to be measured. With reference to that particular sets, only these equations are correct. So it should be very, very clear. So this is what we call as a velocity transformation formula. This is the same as the old relative velocity formula, which is inconsistent with the second postulate, as we have just now seen. Because if this formula is valid, has to be valid for light, then in that case, it's not going to be consistent with the second postulate, because then we'll find that the velocity of light will be different in different frames, and that's what we want to avoid. That's what we do not want. We want that velocity of light should be same in all the frame if we believe in the second postulate of Einstein. And this is the inverse velocity formula. Let's not go into the detail of the inverse velocity formula. So what we have to do, we have to now look for a transformation which is consistent with the second postulate and can make speed of light same in all inertial frames. That's what we are aiming at. And Einstein, after a lot of thought, in fact, that's what he said, after a lot of thought, he thought it's basically time which is the culprit. Basically, the assumption that t prime is equal to t, that both the observers make the observation at the same, for an event, both the observers will claim the time to be same. That's what he objected. Okay, so let's give some examples, try to understand how it's possible. So this is what I said, time is suspect. Now, let's like try to take some sort of examples. Generally, time is measured, the way we measure time is sort of related to simultaneity of two events. If I say that a train starts from CST station, let's say at 10 a.m., it essentially means that when the train starts, there's one event, the train has left the station, just left the station, and there is another event, which is the time in my watch. I would look at the watch and I find it's exactly 10 o'clock, okay? And these two events are simultaneous. It means when my watch shows 10 o'clock, that's one event, and when the train departs, that's the second event. Both have occurred at the same time, okay? Similarly, I can say my class will start at 11:30. It means when this particular time the watch will be 11:30, and when my class starts, these two events will be together. They will occur simultaneously. They will happen, appear to be in the same time. So this is what I say. It essentially relates to some sort of simultaneity. So a train leaving at 10 a.m. implies that train leaving and clock showing 10 a.m. are simultaneous events. We now want to show that if second postulate is correct, if Einstein's second postulate is correct, then simultaneity is relative. Two events which appear to be simultaneous in a given frame may not appear to be simultaneous in a different frame. So let us first look at that and convince ourselves that time could be frame dependent. Then we will look into the actual transformation, which is the Lorentz transformation. All right. So let us take another example. So let's assume that we are in a, this is sort of a train compartment, okay? And I'm sitting or standing just at the middle of this compartment. Then I throw a ball to the right hand side and a ball at the same time to the left hand side. All right. Let's assume that this particular train is moving. I'm in a compartment. This is moving relative to a particular velocity in, let's say, another frame of reference, which is, let's suppose, Earth frame of reference. Let's assume that we are in a room. Now we describe two events. Event number one, when this particular ball which I have thrown here hits the back wall. Let's suppose we are moving in this particular direction relative to, let's say, outside. So let's call one event when this particular ball hits the back wall, and event number two, the second event, when this particular ball hits the front wall. So I have two balls in my hand, I throw just like this, okay? This ball will go and hit this particular ball. This particular ball will go and hit this particular ball. Let's assume that my velocity is enough so that the ball will not fall and hit the ground, okay, before it collides to the wall. So this is what I have written. An observer is exactly halfway in a running compartment of length L. So let's assume that this length is L. He throws two balls, okay, at the same time T prime is equal to 0. So let's assume that T prime was equal to 0. With the same speed u prime, of course, I must add that the velocity which of the ball relative to me, I throw with it exactly the same velocity. As measured by him, one towards the front wall and another towards the back wall. Is this idea clear? So this is what I have drawn. It's a sort of a cartoon of this particular thing that, you know, of course, my man looks too big in comparison to compartment, but it's just for illustration purposes that, you know, there is a ball here, there is another ball. So this particular person, remember these velocities u prime, because I have put primes, okay, are all measured relative to s prime. All right. So that's the notation which should be very clear. So that's what I have written, u prime. So I am sitting in s prime frame of reference, and therefore the velocities with which I am throwing the balls, okay, are measured according to me. Okay. So relative to me, this particular ball and this particular ball moves with the same velocity, which is u prime. So this is thrown like this, this is thrown like this. So I describe my event. Event number one, the first ball reaches the front wall. Okay. My event number one is that this ball comes and hits this particular ball. My event number two is that second ball comes and hits at the back wall. Now my question is, very simple question, are events one and two simultaneous? Okay, implying whether they occur at the same time. All right. At the moment, I am observer which is sitting in S prime frame of reference. Okay. You will realize that this particular ball has to travel a distance of L by 2 because this length of this compartment is L. Remember, we are talking still of classical mechanics. All right. So this particular ball has to travel a distance of L by 2 because I am sitting half the way. This ball also has to travel a distance of L by 2. This is thrown with a speed of u prime. This is also thrown with the speed of u prime. So time that it will take to travel from here to that particular wall will be L upon 2 divided by u. Time taken for this ball to reach this particular wall will be same L by 2 divided by u prime rather. All right. So according to me, I will find that this event of this particular ball hitting and this particular event of this particular ball hitting this ball are simultaneous. They occur at the same time. All right. Before I go to slight mathematics, let's just first understand observation. Now let us imagine with respect to the observer on the ground. All right. Now look at this particular person. Now what will happen? According to this person, when this ball has been thrown in this particular direction, it is not actually thrown with a velocity u prime. Okay, classical velocity addition formula. He will find that actually the velocity of the ball is u prime plus v. All right. On the other hand, according to this observer, this ball does not travel with velocity u prime, but travels with a velocity v minus u prime. All right. So according to this particular person, this ball is actually traveling with a larger velocity, while this particular ball is traveling with a smaller velocity. Okay, remember the observation is now being made with respect to the observer in ground. All right. But on the other hand, as this ball, I'm now looking with respect to this particular person. As this particular ball is moving towards right, this train compartment is also moving towards right. All right. So actually ball has to travel a larger distance to hit the ball, to catch the ball. All right. On the other hand, as far as this particular ball is concerned, though it's moving with a slower velocity, but this particular ball here is coming towards the ball. So this particular ball has to travel a smaller distance to hit the ball. Okay. And I can do a small calculation. Okay. You will find that according to this particular observer also, these two events will turn out to be simultaneous. All right. The classical mechanics has been designed in that particular fashion. Okay. So this ball travels with a larger velocity, but travels also a larger distance. This particular ball travels with a smaller velocity, but travels a smaller distance. And if you do a small calculation, you will find that time taken for this particular ball to hit this wall will be exactly same as the time taken for this particular ball to hit this particular wall. So let's first talk in S prime frame of reference. That's the train frame of reference that we agreed that time for the first event was L by 2 u prime. We just now agreed that was for event number 1, that's the ball hitting the front wall. For the second event, the time was L divided by 2 u prime, exactly the same thing. Nothing has changed as far as this particular person is concerned. Hence, the two events are simultaneous in this frame of reference. Now, if I go with respect to the ground observer, the speed of the first ball using the inverse velocity transformation, which I have used just now, is ux is equal to ux prime plus v. So the first ball travels with a larger speed, ux prime plus v, while the second ball travels with a smaller speed, which is v minus u prime. All right. Now we go to slightly different thing. How much distance this particular ball will travel in the time t1, if the time t1 is the time taken for the collision. So this will be vt1. So first ball has to travel a distance of L by 2 plus vt1. Okay. And it has to cover that distance with a speed u prime plus v. The second ball has to travel a distance smaller by vt2. Okay. And it has to travel the distance by v minus u prime. You calculate t1 prime and t2 prime, this will give you exactly the same thing. Okay, in fact, the t1 is equal to t2, is equal to t1 prime, is equal to t2 prime. All, everyone will agree, as well as prime will agree, that both the events were simultaneous. And those events occurred at a time L upon 2u prime. As far as observer S is concerned, as far as observer S prime is concerned, both will agree that these particular events occurred at the same time and at a time L upon 2u prime. This was a purely a classical treatment. Now let us introduce light. Let us introduce the second postulate of special theory of relativity. Now instead of these balls, let's assume that I have two small bulbs, two torches, I flash like this, you know, I flash like one in this side, I flash on this at the same time. So I have two similar type of torches, or laser beam or whatever you want to call it, you flash exactly at the same time. Everything's identical, Except that instead of ball, I am talking of now light. Okay, and now I am assuming that second postulate of Einstein is correct, that velocity of light is same in all the frames. So what, that's what I write. Now imagine that the observer shines light instead of throwing balls, which travel both in front and the back direction. Event one, light reaches the front wall, exactly the same thing. Instead of ball, I have replaced it by light. So my event one is that light reaches that wall. My event two is that light reaches the back wall. Let us try to analyze this particular thing in S prime frame of reference. This is the cartoon again for that. Instead of ball, I have put some flashes of light. Now you will agree that as far as S prime is concerned, it makes no difference. Instead of U prime, all that he has to do is to use C. Okay. So time for the first event will be T1 prime is equal to L upon 2C. Time for the second event will be L upon 2C. All right. Because all that has become different is that instead of that ball velocity which was U prime, okay, now it has become C. All right. Now let's look from the point of view of an observer on the ground. Now according to this particular observer, if the second postulate is correct, this velocity has not changed. That particular person will also observe the velocity to be C, if second postulate is correct. This velocity will also be C, if second postulate is correct. But on the other hand, according to this observer here, this light has to travel a larger distance because this particular wall is actually traveling forward. All right, while this particular light has to travel a smaller distance because this particular wall is traveling towards the light. You agree with that particular statement? Yeah.
What is the value of velocity?
V could be anything, I don't care.
Because if it is small value, then there will be hardly any effect.
No, see, thing is that whether it's a measurable or not, that's a different question. Okay, please, please, you know, see, questions are always welcome. See, let's not give, I mean, there is no teaching without questions. I mean, that's first thing which you always say, that all questions are all welcome. There is no question which is a foolish question. There is always a question. I mean, it could be different of perception. See, thing is that V is very smaller. If V turns out to be smaller, very small in comparison to C, the effect may be not so much measurable. That's a different question. Okay, I'm not talking of at the moment experimental way of doing it. All I'm saying is that will there be difference, whether it's measurable or not, that's a different question. See, theoretically speaking, there will be difference. Whether V is smaller or whether V is larger, okay, does not make a difference. There has to be difference. Because basically in our classical mechanics, things were saved, the time turned out to be identical. Because of course, one particular ball has to travel a larger distance, but the velocity was also larger. Okay, another ball has to travel a smaller distance, but the velocity was also smaller. So the two events which were appeared to be simultaneous in S prime also turned out to be simultaneous in S frame. Basic difference is that instead of ball, if I am using light, okay, and if second postulate is correct, okay, first statement is no longer correct. Second statement is still correct. This particular wall is still moving with respect to S prime frame. But this particular light velocity has not changed. So this particular light has to travel now a larger distance to reach, but with the same velocity C. While a light which has moved in this particular direction, according to observer sitting on the ground, has to move a smaller distance, okay, but with the same velocity C. Obviously, according to the observer on the ground, if second postulate is correct, the second event will occur first, and event number one will occur later. Because two velocities are identical, but one has to travel a larger distance, another has to travel a smaller distance. So two events which appear to be simultaneous in S prime frame will not appear to be simultaneous in S frame. The time difference may be very small, that's a different question, but they are different. That's what is the idea. Okay, it means the two events which are simultaneous in a frame may not appear to be simultaneous in any other frame. It means the concept of time, which was basically involving some simultaneity, probably may not be correct. It means the time that we are measuring may also be different in different frames. It means T prime is equal to T or T is equal to T prime that we have written in the Galilean transformation may not be correct. That's what Einstein started looking into it and sort of working on it. Yes, please.
So that means when the light gets reflected to the walls and again comes back to the person, then they will not reach simultaneously. One ray of light will come first and then the other ray of light. Suppose, sir, I design a thought experiment where there is a photocatalytic reaction, chemical reaction. For the person who is sitting inside the train, for him the two lights are coming together, so the reaction takes place. For the other person who is standing outside the train, for him one light comes faster and another light reaches later. So for him the reaction doesn't take place, same chemical reaction. So how will you interpret it?
No. I'm not very sure what you mean by chemical reaction, because as far as I'm concerned, chemical reaction, these two are sort of independent thing. This particular chemical reaction and this particular chemical reaction are independent. So in a particular frame, the chemical two chemical reactions will appear to be occurring at the same time. According to another person, they will not appear to be occurring at the same time.
Suppose, sir, there is a significant amount of light needed for a say photoelectric effect, not chemical reaction.
Okay, photoelectric. Let's say photoelectric effect. Okay. See, I send a photon here. Uh-huh. Some certain amount of electrons are started coming there. Okay. Now, according to me, electron coming from this particular source and this particular source, they started together. Hmm. According to observer on ground, they started together at different time. So when the electrons started getting emitted from here first and electrons started getting emitted from there later.
Okay, if it is at the two ends. But yes. Sir, suppose light is coming back towards the person and meeting him again.
Yeah.
Then for the person who is standing on the train, moving with the train, for him the two rays of light are coming together, meeting together.
Yes.
So more electricity will be generated in the photoelectric effect. No,
let's discuss it out later. I'm not sure what you have in mind. See, thing is that basically we have to talk in terms of event. What we are talking of the events. Okay, we should define our events. Let us try to find out what is the time of the event. Okay, because when the light has to come, the things will become different. Because then that particular light will change the role. Now this particular light has to travel a smaller distance. Okay, now this light has to travel a larger distance. The roles have been interchanged. Okay. So things may become different. So I'm not sure whether I have answered your question. But you know, things that you have to look at the entire event holistically and talk in terms of events. All right. Now, I am not calculating the time difference of the two events as seen in these two frames, because until we have done Lorentz transformation, which is a little more complex, I don't want to go. My idea is only to tell that the events which appear to be simultaneous in a given frame may not be simultaneous in another frame. That was one example which I just now
offered. I have a question.
Yeah.
Actually, you are suggesting to teach relativity in simultaneous.
Yeah.
Before you deal with Lorentz transformation.
That's what I like to do.
Yeah.
That's what I
But
like
if some student who knows about Lorentz transformation, I mean, at least contraction, he doesn't know about the expression and all these things, but he has a heart of contraction. He may ask that the length will be contracted and how are you?
See, the thing is that, you know, it does happen. In IIT also happens. Yeah. There are a lot of students who are already well-read and they have a lot of, I mean, in fact, one of my colleagues, let me be honest, I'm not a specialist in special theory relativity. I do not work in the area of relativity. I'm not a theoretical physicist either. But some of the people who are in my department who work on relativity, I mean, first thing which they always say that you must tell to the students to avoid use of length contraction as far as possible. Because length contraction is most of the time misused rather than being used. Okay, I will not be able to talk about length contraction in this particular course because we don't have that much time. Okay, but if you are interested, we can discuss it later. See, length contraction always involves what you call it a proper length, and when this particular proper length is to be measured in a different frame of reference. Unfortunately, what happens, whenever a student sees a length, first thing they will do, contract it. Okay. So, I want to totally avoid the use of length contraction. In fact, these are shortcuts. Length contraction, time dilation are shortcut methods of solving the problems. And many times people tend to misuse them. I say always apply Lorentz transformation directly. Do not talk about length contraction. Okay? If length contraction comes, it will come automatically. Okay? Unless you are very, very sure, at least talk of the two events. Talk what happens, whether the length that you are talking is really a proper length. Okay, when you are talking of proper length, by the way, is the length which is measured in a frame of reference in which the rod is at rest. All right, so then only we talk about it. Yes.
Sir, I would like to add a point. In the Lorentz transformation derivation that we have, there itself the concept of simultaneity is hidden, implicit, because we calculate a point where a light has reached and then we calculate the distances. That point is actually observed at two different times by the two observers. So simultaneity is actually hidden in that derivation.
It's automatically part of there. Yes. Yeah.
What would happen if that value of B becomes equal to C?
That's a very interesting question because, you know, see, unfortunately, at when you are talking of velocity v equal to c or v greater than c, many strange things start happening. At v is equal to c, you start having a discontinuity in the medium, I mean, on all the expression. When v becomes greater than c, then all the expressions start becoming imaginary. I mean, mathematically, people, that's the argument people give, that velocity is greater than velocity of light should not be valid. But there are better reasons. In fact, again, I'll not be able to talk about it. If you want, you can look at my lectures, which I have given in NPTEL. Okay.
Is it just discontinuity or
the postulate tells us that?
No. See, postulate does not talk about the speed of light. Postulate only talks the speed of light being constant.
Yes.
Now, when we are talking of this particular thing, that y velocity is greater.
Sorry, sir. Yes. Actually, speed of light is equal to c with respect to any observer, inertial observer.
Yeah.
So no observer can move, no observer can be a co-mover of light.
See, I'm not very sure whether this is really implied in that statement. All that saying that it's...
If someone's speed is c with respect to me...
I have to look at my relative velocity formula. The thing is that I have not yet looked at my relative velocity formula. If I look at my relative velocity formula, what happens at c is equal to c, that v is equal to c, that becomes a little more complex. But the thing is that even if I am moving at the speed of 0.999 c, this way another observer is moving at the speed of 0.999 c, if you go to another frame of reference, you will still find relative velocity smaller than c. Okay, but if you you tend close to c, this will also tend to c. But what I wanted to say is the better argument which I give in terms of why speed is greater than the speed of light should not be allowed is the more physical argument, which is we call as a causality, that the cause must precede the outcome. See, as I generally say, that if I shoot somebody, it should not happen in some other frame of reference that person dies first before the gun is shot. So it means, see, when there are two events which are related, okay, one event, two events could be totally unrelated. For example, this train is starting, this class starting, and a train is starting from VT station. Okay, these are totally uncorrelated statement relation. Okay, they can always differ. In one particular frame of reference, it may happen the class started first, and another frame of reference, the train started first. That may be all right. But if that train moved because of my class starting, which of course not doesn't happen, we can always imagine two events, like for example, somebody dying because somebody shooting. Okay, that person died because somebody shot at him. Okay, then these are cause and outcome related. So second event happened because the first event happened. Okay, in that case, it should not be possible that in any other frame of reference, the cause appears to be later and the outcome appears to be first. That you first see in a particular frame of reference that a person has died. Then we find out that the gun has been shot. Okay, so that should not happen. And that's only possible if we avoid velocities greater than velocity of light. So this is what is called causality, the concept of causality. And this is the causality, which I think is a much more important physical ground for saying that velocities greater than velocity of light are not acceptable. But as you say, I agree with this particular thing. I normally try, because as I say, I find students still being very shocked when I say that t is not equal to t prime. In fact, almost every year some of the student feels very disturbed and will always ask the question, isn't there any other way? So this is the way, unfortunately, this is a really shocking statement. So therefore, I want to emphasize on this statement first, emphasize that T and T prime can be different. Then only talk about Lorentz transformation, rather than talking about Lorentz transformation first and then telling that, T is different from T prime. Yeah.
So you said that if the velocity, if V becomes greater than C, then you have that causality problem. But you also said that we have to deal with imaginary numbers.
Yeah. See, in Lorentz transformation, you get always an imaginary number.
How do we physically interpret this imaginary numbers appearing into the...
The thing is that that's a more of a mathematical treatment, it's true that, let me just talk, let me call it a sort of loud thinking, when there was the famous experiment, which was being happened, an LHC experiment was being conducted. There was once a report that particles greater than particle speed of light has probably been seen. Of course, that was denied after some time that this particular thing was not very, very sure. And then a lot of people were thinking, even in our department, can't the rest mass be imaginary? Because this particular particle can you know, in principle can never be put to rest. Okay, so I mean, thing is that, you know, if you have that event, probably people can get across. I mean, we use imaginary numbers for many things. In, I mean, see, whole of your quantum mechanics wave function is based on imaginary things.
But we don't measure imaginary numbers.
We don't measure imaginary numbers. So things that, see, question is that when you can measure only real numbers, but in order to achieve at real numbers, okay, you may always use imaginary numbers. Okay, that's what we do in quantum mechanics, for example. Yeah.
So those are measured for x.
No, so I mean that's what I'm saying. It's a sort of loud thinking. We are thinking that, you know, rest mass, you know, for example, the particle can never be put to rest. So what is the rest mass? Can't we call rest mass as imaginary? Can't we make all those numbers, you know, real? I mean, see, nobody has visualized those things. So it's probably, you know, not very good idea to talk about it later. But things that maybe there is a way of handling those numbers. Maybe, I do not know whether there is. I mean, I'm not saying that there will be a way. Okay, maybe there is a way. Okay, but the physics arguments we always believe much more strongly. Okay, because if this would have happened, if causality was violated, someday I would have seen in my frame of reference some causality to be violated, which I have never seen. Someday in my frame of reference, I would have seen somewhere in the sky that the cause occurred later and the outcome came first. I have never seen that thing.
But when we say the time is different,
yeah,
then we have to think about that.
Then you have to think about what?
No, we'll be able to predict the future.
See, I'm not very sure whether it means that. Because see, the thing is that, you know, I mean, let me also put it, I mean, there are a lot of paradoxes, there are a lot of things which people talk about, especially relativity. I take a concentrated effort of not to talk to them, talk about them, because many of these things are looking very attractive and probably glamorous to talk about those things. But eventually when you start dealing with physics, you always find that there is a loophole in their argument. Okay, so that's the reason I purposely avoid talking, and I want to talk of mainly those things which are directly physical. So none of the paradoxes, twin paradox, etc., all those things, looking at future, all those things, I want to talk about it. Because they always assume certain type of things. See, you can always happen, and then you can meet together, and then you can have exchange notes. Now, there are many ifs and buts in there. So they are more of a sort of glamorous thing to talk about the relativity. But I normally avoid those things, you know, as I said, you know. Okay, let's go ahead and, okay, so this is what I had said, that in S prime frame, these are the two events which are simultaneous. Now, according to S prime, the two events are simultaneous. This is because S prime, the light covers the same distance in front direction as back with the same speed. Now, according to S observer, which is the observer on ground, the speed of light is still C in both the directions according to the second postulate, but it has to travel a larger distance to reach the front wall than the back wall. So the two events in S prime frame of reference would not turn out to be simultaneous. Therefore, probably it's not a bad idea to assume that time is also a frame dependent quantity. And that's what Einstein did. So this is what is the conclusion of whatever we have discussed. There is a simultaneity of two events in S prime, but not in S. Simultaneity of two events thus depends on the frame chosen. Thus, time may have to be taken as a frame dependent if we have to make C independent of frame. That's what is the basic idea. And talk a little bit about that, how time should be frame dependent quantity. So I repeat, as somebody has mentioned, that I normally prefer to discuss this aspect first before discussing Lorentz transformation, just because I think people are generally very uncomfortable with the idea of time becoming frame dependent quantity. So this probably I will go very fast. This is the basic equations. Of course, there are certain physical arguments by which we can arrive at these equations. If you look at the Resnick's book, they have given details of how these, starting from the most general arguments, how the transformation should come to this particular form. But I will here start with this particular thing. So I assume that instead of the Galilean transformation, my transformation has become somewhat different. Basic difference here is that in Galilean transformation, I had x prime is equal to x minus vt. Now this has been multiplied by a constant bxx prime, well, bxx. As far as these two things are concerned, this is same as the Galilean transformation. The third thing that I have made is time dependent on frame. So t prime is no longer equal to t, but t prime is related to x and t. So t prime becomes btx into x. So because this is related to x, so I have put x symbol here. This is related to t, so I have put the t symbol. So btx into x plus btt into t. Now it's very clear that if my BXS was 1 and BTX was equal to 0 and BTT was also equal to 1, this will lead to a Galilean transformation. So just we have generalized little more the Galilean transformation. Of course, people can always ask the question why equation should be only in this particular form. There are profound physics arguments on the basis of this particular thing. As I said, if you look at the Resnick's book, he starts with the most general transformation. He says, let's suppose we are totally in dark. So let's assume that x is, depends on x, y, z, t, x square, y square, z square, x cube, all those things. Then he starts giving physics arguments. In fact, if you want to do that, normally it takes about 1 to 2 hours itself to say how from those most general arguments I will arrive at these equations. So all I want to say that this is not just randomly that I have chosen these things. There is a physical argument on the basis of which you can argue it out that these equations should be of this particular form. All that is now required to be known are these three constants, BXX, BTX and BTT. And the only thing that we have in our control is that I want that the speed of light should be same in all the inertial frame of reference.
Is it an X or B?
Which one? Here? So this is BTX, this is BTT.
Product of BTX.
Here? No, which equation are you talking?
BTX, BTX.
No, here they see the thing is that because this is a relation between x and time, so this constant I am calling is BTX. So dx, TX is subscript. So this I am calling is TT because this is relating time part of the component to time. Here, because this is relating to x component, actually this you can of course, in principle I should have written BXXX into BXT, okay? But on the other hand, because both the constants turn out to be same, which also we can argue it out, therefore I have just used BXX, okay? If you are, that's what is your objection. So this, because there is x component here, there is also a time component. If you want, I can avoid XX, it does not matter. So, it's just a matter of, again, the way you want to put a constant. You can put just ABCD. And X, Y, Z, it doesn't make any difference.
One is BXX.
Yeah.
This
one.
Everyone can ask that you have taken the same coefficient for X and T.
Yeah.
Times V.
Yeah, that's right.
Why? You have.
That's what I say. If any student asks about this question, I would always say that I do completely because one can put an argument on this particular thing. See, you can look at that origin, the way the origins are displaced with respect to this. This particular equation must be of the form X minus VT. Because, see, remember, this particular origin has to travel related to another origin such that any event which happens here must translate x minus, an event which happens at origin here at x prime must happen at a distance of vt with respect to s prime. S prime.
Why not xx dash
on the bxx? I'm sorry. See, what you are saying is that why I take, no, I'm not taking, I mean, that's what I'm saying. This constant you can call anything, that does not matter.
No, the question is, B11 and B14
same. That's precisely what I'm trying to say. See, I want to put this particular equation always in the form of X minus VT. That's what is the basic argument. Because if an event happens at the origin of S prime, okay, then according to S, that event must be occurring at X is equal to VT. Because that's what is our condition, that this particular frame of reference is moving related to the first frame of reference with a relative velocity of V. So if an event occurred at x prime is equal to at origin of that thing, that must occur at x is equal to vt with respect to the ground frame of reference.
At x minus vt.
Yeah. So therefore, whatever you say, if you put x is equal to vt, x prime must be equal to 0. That's all. Okay. Therefore, this equation has to be of this particular form. There is no other way. All right. So as I say, for all these things, there are arguments. I can start with the most general thing and come to this. And in fact, even if you look at my video lectures where I have started with most general equation and really talked about all those things and come to this particular equation. But that takes one full lecture only on that particular arguments, how these particular constants should be. Because there are a lot of physics arguments. Actually, they're very profound arguments, very interesting arguments. Okay. But one can show that this equation must be of this particular form. Okay. Then our standard thing is that. Okay, it's easy to see that these equations satisfy the condition of time being zero when the origins of the two frame coincide, because this is the way we started with that. And now we take the standard derivation, making velocity of light same in the two frame of reference. So I assume that at t is equal to t prime is equal to zero. That was the time when the origins of both the frames coincided. a spherical light front was emitted from the origin. Okay, so this particular frame of reference moves in a spherical wave front starting with the center at the origin. Now, because of observer S as well as prime observer, both will feel that velocity of light is same in all the directions. So, as the time keeps on progressing, both of the frame of reference, both the observers will feel that this spherical wavefront is still moving with respect to their center, with respect to their origin as center of the sphere. So, this is what is the standard, I mean, every textbook gives this particular picture, that though this particular wavefront started when their origins were coincident, but at a later time when their origins were separated, even at that particular instant of time, it would appear that this particular red observer will feel that this is a wavefront with this origin as the center of the wavefront. This particular observer would also feel that there is a wavefront which is spherical, which is with the origin at his center, O prime. All right, because according to both the observers, light moves in the same, with the same speed in all the directions. It is independent of the relative velocity between the frames. I am not saying the source which emitted the light was fixed in which frame of reference. I mean, had it been a ball in classical mechanics, okay, I would have said whether a ball was thrown from the origin S or origin of S or S prime. But light is immaterial. Whether the light source was fixed in S, or whether it was fixed in S prime, or it was fixed neither in S or not in S prime, is immaterial. Okay, what is important, that this particular light was emitted when the origins of the two frames were coincident. Where light source was fixed is of no consequence. All right, because whatever you do for light, the light has to move with the same speed c in all the frames. Now, once you do this particular thing, you can always write that these are the equations of the wavefronts, which are the equations of spherical sphere. The radius at any given time t will be c times t, where t is the time measured in that particular person's frame of reference. So remember, when we write these particular equations, we write x square plus y square plus z square, c square t square, because this is according to S observer. All the observations are being made in that person's frame of reference. Here, everything is being made in S prime's frame of reference. So here I am using x prime, here I am using y prime, z prime, and here also I am using t prime. Okay? Remember, we cannot get confused between the frames of reference. We have to be consistent in our own frame of reference. As far as S prime observer is concerned, according to that person, the coordinates are x prime, y prime, z prime, time is t prime. According to the person in S frame of reference, coordinates are x, y, z, and time is t. Okay? Once we have done that, then you all substitute those equations. Now, these are things.
Now, ct primed is equal to?
I don't say anything, but the ct prime is equal to anything. See, there are two observers which
to
are
draw making. The same radius.
No, see, that's what I'm, okay. I have drawn so that radius appears to be same. You can treat it to be different. This is only a pictorial representation of the spherical wavefront. Okay, the radius could be different. Okay, depending on at what, then we are talking of the events. So that don't get guided or misguided by this particular thing.
I want to say that this can create a misconception.
Okay, so probably I should have drawn a sphere of slightly different idea.
Centers are coinciding.
See, the origins were coincident at the time when the wavefront was emitted. Okay, at that time the radius was zero. Okay, now as for a time they keep on moving apart from each other. Okay, but both of them will feel that the wavefront is still spherical and their origin is still the center. That's all I'm trying to say. All right, because it does not matter. C moves with the same speed in every direction. That's all I'm trying to say. Okay. See, when you want to compare what is happening between S and S prime, it's a little more complex because you have to look at Lorentz transform. You have to talk about event. Okay, when you made the event and measurement and things like that. You know, that's a little more complex. So let's not go into the. Okay. So these are just the equations which. I will not go into the details of these things. And finally, this is what you land up as what we call as the Lorentz transformation. Normally, we use these type of abbreviations. We always call beta is equal to V upon C. Very, very standard notation. I mean, anybody in relativity, if you call beta, everyone knows this is what you call as a boost factor, V upon C. And gamma is 1 upon under root 1 minus beta square. So in a simplified form, this is the way your Lorentz transformation looks like. X prime is equal to gamma x minus yt. Instead of 1, it has become gamma. And this is t prime is equal to gamma t minus vx upon c square. So this is the well-known Lorentz transformation. Basically, there are certain observations which I will not be able to discuss too much in detail, but they are sort of obvious. If you have any doubt, you can always discuss with me. In the classical limit, that is when v is much smaller than c, the Lorentz transformation reduces to Galilean transformation, which can be very easily see because gamma will be very close to 1, because gamma depends upon 1 upon under root 1 minus v square by c square. So in fact, you will start getting relativistic correction only. See, remember, when v is equal to 0.1 c, gamma will become 0.01 of that order. So you will start getting approximately 1% correction when only your velocity becomes of the order 0.1 c. So long your velocities are smaller than 0.1 c, you are probably making hardly any difference by using classical equations. Only when your velocities are much larger, then you will start getting effects, relativistic effects. And of course, as many of we have just now discussed, that if v is greater than c, this gamma factor will become imaginary, which we do not know as of now how to handle it. The inverse transformation can be written just as I said, same formula, change the sign of v, put prime to unprime, unprime to prime. Now let's come to velocity transformation. Now here, before we go to the velocity transformation, let's be a little clear about notation, because this is again one point where people get thoroughly confused. When I am talking of velocity transformation, unfortunately, there are three velocities which come into the picture. So let's be very clear that we do not make a mistake about it. Symbol v in relativity is always reserved between relative velocity of the frame. Okay, and this v has to be constant because the two frames are inertial. That we discussed right in our first lecture. Okay, so as far as the relative velocity between the frames is concerned, is v. Now let's imagine that there is a particle which is moving. This particular particle may not move with a constant velocity. All right, it could have any arbitrary motion. Now when I am looking at that particle's instantaneous velocity, velocity at a given time, okay, the symbol that I use is u. So u is reserved for particle velocity, v is reserved for relative velocity between frames. Let's be very, very clear. Never get confused about this thing. Because as soon as three velocity expressions start coming, people start getting a little concerned about it. V is reserved for relative velocity between the frames, which has to be always constant. Symbol u is reserved for particle velocity. If it is being observed in S frame of reference, then that particular velocity will be called u. If the velocity of the same particle is being observed in S prime frame of reference, then I call it u prime. We have three velocities, u, u prime, v. V, relative velocity, u, velocity of the particle as observed in S frame, u prime, the velocity of the same particle being observed in S prime frame of reference. Okay? And of course, u and u prime need not be constant because the particle could be accelerated. See, I might be looking at the dynamics of a particular particle. I might have applied a force on that particular particle. That particle might be accelerating. I may be looking into the dynamics of that particular particle. Okay, therefore, there is no restriction on the particle velocity. But on the relative velocity between the frames, that has to be constant because the two frames are inertial frame. So v is relative velocity between frames, constant as a function of time. U, instantaneous velocity of particle in S, need not be constant. U prime, instantaneous velocity of the particle in S prime, need not be constant. Now, generally we talk about events. Unfortunately, I had not been able to give some examples which I would have loved to give. Probably in December course, I will add some examples, which makes things a little more clearer before we come to the velocity transformation. Especially length contraction and time dilation, I have totally avoided, which normally we try to do specifically to make students careful when to use length contraction, when to use time dilation, okay, or better not to use them. So let's suppose there are two events. First, in S frame, we observe a particular particle and make an observation about the location of a particular particle, and that particular observation we make at time t1. So this becomes my event. See, I observe a particle at given time here. So at that time, my watch shows time t1, and I find that it's located at x is equal to x1. This is one observation. Then after a little bit of time, my watch starts showing time t2. Then again, I make a second observation and find out what is the location of the particle, and I find that particle now exists at x is equal to x2. So these are two events. Observation was made about the location of the particle, which happened at x is equal to x1. Let's assume y and z equal to 0. We'll introduce y and z a little later. All right. And we made the second observation of the same particle in S frame of reference. And I found out that now this particular particle is located at time at x2. And at that time, I was sure time t2. So this is particle, this is event 1. Particle found at x1 at time t1. Event 2, particle found at x2 at time t is equal to t2. Even if the velocity of the particle is not constant, if I take delta t as t2 minus t1, in the limit delta t tending to 0, delta x upon delta t will be defined as the velocity of the particle measured in S frame. Let's be very, very clear. If I am talking of S frame velocity, delta x has to be measured in S frame, delta t also has to be measured in S frame. I cannot take delta t from any other frame of reference. Okay, delta t has to be in my frame of reference, delta s has to be in my frame of reference. In a given problem, if delta t has not been given in my frame of reference, I have to use a proper transformation to get delta t prime from another frame of reference to this particular frame of reference. All right. Now, similarly, if the motion is in general in three dimension, I can define my ux, uy, uz, the x, y, and z component of the velocities in S frame as limit delta t tending to 0, delta x divided by delta t, delta y divided by delta t, etc., etc. So this is the way how I would define the x, y, and z component of the velocities in S frame of reference, okay, using two events. Similarly, I can define the velocity component in S prime frame of reference. I look at the same two events, okay. Event number one was locating the particle position. Now this event was also being observed in S prime. That particular person will feel that this particular event actually did not occur at x is equal to x1, but occurred at x is equal to x1 prime. And now because time is also frame dependent quantity, so that person will observe that this event actually occurred at t is equal to t1 prime. Similarly, event number 2, according to that particular person, would be observed at x2 prime and at time t2 prime. And when that person calculates the velocity of that particular particle, that person has to use his delta x prime, his delta t prime, and divide the two. Okay? He cannot take delta t of the S frame and divide by the two. He has to take delta t of S prime frame of reference and divide by 2. So this is what is most important, that it has to be delta x prime divided by delta t prime as delta t prime tends to 0. Basic message is that a person has to be consistent in his or her frame of reference. When I am making measurements in this particular frame of reference, I am measuring time in my frame of reference, I am measuring position in my frame of reference. That's what's the most important thing to realize. Now I use Lorentz transformation, what I call as a differential mode. So it was x is equal to minus gamma, x prime is equal to minus gamma x minus vt. So I take x1 and x2, take subtract these two, I have sort of missed two or three steps, which we call Lorentz transformation in differential mode. Just put deltas on all the variables. It means take two things, subtract one out of the two. Okay. Then substitute in these equations. So you have delta x prime into by delta t prime. So delta x prime I have substituted from this thing, gamma delta x minus v delta t. Delta t prime I have substituted this thing. This gamma and gamma will cancel out. So this is what I get. Then just manipulate the terms, I get the expression ux prime is equal to ux minus v divided by 1 minus v ux upon c square. Remember, in the Galilean velocity transformation, this particular factor was just this. This denominator is extra, which ensures that relative velocity will never exceed speed of light. Similarly, delta v thing, similarly this thing. And eventually, this is what happens as the final velocity transformation. The only thing which has to be remembered here, that in the first one there is no gamma in the denominator, in the second one there is a gamma denominator, second, third also there is a gamma in the denominator. See, it means uy prime is no longer equal to uy. Remember, y was prime was equal to y, but uy prime is not equal to uy. Similarly, uz prime is not equal to uz. Okay, this is getting still divided by this particular factor. That's what is the velocity transformation. This is the inverse velocity transformation. So we can see from this equation that if u is less than c in a frame of reference, it will be same in all other frames also. If u is equal to c in a frame, it would be same in other frames also. It can be very easily seen. You can take squares of these things and add. It requires a little bit of mathematics. You can show that if u is equal to c in one frame, u prime has to be equal to c. So this is the way we had derived it. So these equations are consistent with the second postulate of special theory of relativity. So these are the equations of velocity transformation that normally we should use. Yes.
Sir, all the derivations that you have done, you have used second postulate of relativity.
Yeah.
Sir, where is the first postulate?
That's what I'm coming to. That's what I precisely am coming to it. Okay.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
I wanted the notations of differentiation. Is there any reason for that in the derivation?
See, that's the standard notation that we use for every differentiation. See, we start with deltas, which we are assuming that difference is sort of finite, and let that difference tend to zero.
But we are dealing with
inertial frames, so
it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Okay. See, even if this is inertial frame, the particle is moving from here to here. And in principle, if the particle is accelerated, the distance delta x, if I am taking at this as t is equal to 1 second and I am taking at t is equal to 2 second,
okay,
this delta x will be different. So if I want to look at instantaneous velocity, I must make delta t tend to zero.
But my question was, you have avoided the symbol of d dx.
I have not avoided. You can write d dx, there is absolutely no issue. It's only to simplify the issue, because I want to talk, the basic idea which at least to my students I always want to tell that in relativity you must always talk of events. That's the way I want to talk, because if you do not talk about events, you are likely to make mistakes. So therefore, when I want to go from coordinate transformation to velocity transformation, or from Lorentz transformation to velocity transformation, okay, I want to talk in terms of events. So therefore, I have defined event 1 and event 2, and then take delta x and then let it tend to 0. Okay, if I do not have to talk about this, I can straightway write du dx, dx dt. There is absolutely nothing wrong in that thing. But only because I want to give practice to my students that whenever you talk on terms of events. So how I am going from distance to velocity, okay, you talk of two events, measure the position. Okay, then it becomes easy. But then people will ask, okay, whether this instantaneous velocity was the same time or different time. Now, t is also frame dependent quantity, you are always caught. Okay, so therefore, I always say, talk in terms of an event. Measurement is done. Okay, now, what are the coordinates of that particular event? You can talk of those coordinates being viewed in a different frame of reference. Then you know, if t is this much here, t is equal to t naught, what will be time in S prime frame of reference? Then it becomes easy to talk. So it's always convenient to talk in terms of the events. Otherwise, one gets confused in these things. And last statement which I have written, that you can also show from this particular Lorentz transformation, that if at all it happens that u becomes greater than c in a frame of reference, you can show that in every frame of reference, u will turn out to be greater than c. So you will not be able to find out a frame of reference in which this particular particle will be able to cross the limit u is equal to c. It will always be exceeding u is equal to c, if at all it happens, okay. First two statements, we can always talk about it, that if u prime is less than c, it will always turn out to be less than c in any other frame of reference. And if u is equal to c, then it will turn out to be equal to c in all other frames. Now, I come back to the second thing, which, as you asked, is Lorentz transformation enough? Have we solved our problem of relativity? Question is that, unfortunately, it is not. Okay, we still need to do something more in relativity, because I have to show that this particular thing is consistent with the first postulate. Okay, and the first postulate says that all laws of physics should be same in all the inertial frame of reference. Now, I want to give an example, a very, very standard and simple example. This says that if conservation of momentum, which we believe is a fundamental law of physics, is valid in a frame of reference, if all that we are doing is introducing Lorentz transformation and the velocity transformation, then that momentum will not turn out to be conserved in any given frame of reference. So therefore, we have to redefine momentum and eventually redefine energy, which eventually led to the famous expression E is equal to mc squared. Okay. So, first of all, I discuss that there is a need to define, redefine momentum. So I take a simple example. This is a very well known example, almost all students know about from the high school. This is called a completely inelastic collision. So I have further simplified it by taking masses to be same. So there is a one particular frame of reference in which you find that there is a mass m which moves to the right hand side with a speed of 0.6 c. There is another mass, same mass m, which moves to the left hand side with a speed of 0.6 c. These two masses collide and the collision is completely inelastic. That in classical mechanics means that these two particles get stuck to each other. So finally you find that these particles are just stationary sitting together, okay, and you can see that in this particular process momentum will be conserved because the initial momentum will be m multiplied by 0.6 c, and for this particular particle will be m into minus 0.6 c. It means the sum of the momentum of the two particles will be zero, and when the two particles are at rest, then momentum is zero because the velocity is zero. Okay, in this process we always tell that energy is not conserved. Strictly speaking, energy is always conserved. It's not the it's the mechanical energy which does not get conserved. Okay, the energy is always conserved in the form that it gets generated into heat or sound or whatever are some other effects of energies, but the traditional mechanical energy is not conserved. Of course, there are some collisions which are called elastic collisions, okay, which you differentiate in classical mechanics at our high school, that okay, these are the collisions in which both energy and momentum have to be conserved, while collisions like this only momentum have to be conserved because energy is lost in something else. So this is what it happens, that initial momentum is equal to zero and final momentum is equal to zero, momentum is conserved. Now let us view this particular collision from S prime. So let's assume that I go to a frame of reference of this particular mass m. There is another frame which is now erected with this mass m, okay, or let me put it like that. This is a frame of reference in which this particular mass was initially at rest, okay. After collision it will not be rest. So let's assume that there is another frame of reference S prime which moves to the right hand side with the same speed 0.6 c as that of mass m. So it would appear that in this particular frame of reference this particular mass m is at rest, okay, and apply velocity transformation equation which we have just now derived and see whether we will find momentum to be conserved. As you expect, momentum will not appear to be conserved. So let us view this collision from S prime frame which has v is equal to 0.6 c using velocity transformation. So this simple equation, so ux minus v, so I put ux minus v which is 0.6 c because v is, remember, relative velocity of the frame which is equal to 0.6 c, and ux was also equal to 0.6 c, so numerator will become 0.6 c minus 0.6 c divided by 1 minus ux v upon c square. There is no gamma in ux. Alright, numerator is 0, so this particular velocity will be 0, which is expected because if I am moving in the same frame, in a frame of reference which is the same velocity as that of particle, then this particle will appear to be at rest and that particular frame of reference. Now let's look at the second velocity, particle of the second velocity. This particular particle actually in this particular frame moves in S frame, in the other frame of reference, was moving with velocity of minus 0.6 c. So if I have to find out this particular particle's velocity in S prime frame of reference, then my ux will become minus 0.6 c. V was actually equal to 0.6 c. ux minus v minus 0.6 c minus 0.6 c divided by 1 minus u into vx upon c square. Okay, there is one of them, ux is negative, so therefore it becomes plus, and going a little rapidly, I'm sorry. So this particular velocity will turn out to minus 1.2 divided by 1.36 u. Remember, this velocity will always turn out to be smaller than c as we expect. See, had there only been numerator, then this would have been 1.2 c, which would have been larger than c. But because of this denominator factor, this velocity will turn out to be smaller than velocity of light. Now let's look at the composite particle which we have received, which we have obtained in S frame of reference, original frame of reference, which was at rest. So now according to S prime frame of reference, what would be its velocity? Ux is equal to 0, v is 0.6 c, 1 minus u vx into c square, u is becomes 0, minus 0.6 c. Alright, so according to this particular observer, the two masses which have come to at rest, their velocity will be minus 0.6 c. initial momentum will be, moment of the first particle was zero because velocity was zero. I had calculated velocity as minus 1.2c upon 1.36 times fc. This will be the velocity, momentum, final momentum will be this. So according to this observer, the momentum has not been conserved. Obviously, this is not correct way of defining momentum. I have to define momentum in a different way, because otherwise this will be inconsistent with the first postulate of relativity. Either we say that conservation of momentum is not a good, I mean, it's not a fundamental law of physics. If it is a fundamental law of physics, then it must be obeyed in all the frame of reference, and therefore we must redefine the momentum. So without doing any four vectors, I am just giving the definitions. We define a quantity called rest mass. This is the mass of a particle which is measured in a frame of reference in which the particle is at rest. Now we define the momentum not as just m naught times ux the way I have just now defined, but we put a factor of gamma. Now you may again get confused because I have used gamma u, earlier I have used gamma, but remember I have told you right in the beginning there are three different velocities, v, u, u prime. Alright, when I use v to define gamma, then I will call it gamma. When I use u to define exactly similar expression, I will call it gamma u. This gamma u is u square by c square, which is the particle velocity, which is not the frame velocity. This gamma u need not be constant, because u need not be constant. Alright, just a matter of nomenclature. So gamma u has been defined as 1 upon under root 1 minus u square by c square. Alright, the u will become different in different frame of reference, it will become u prime, and then the gamma corresponding gamma that I will define will be gamma u prime. So like you have three different velocities, you have three different gammas. Gamma corresponding to relative velocity, we just call it gamma. Gamma u corresponding to the particle velocity in S frame, that I will call gamma u. Gamma u need not be constant. Similarly, particle velocity in S prime frame of reference, I will call it gamma u prime. Alright, that also need not be constant. So this is the way I define, if I know ux, uy, uz as the velocity component in a given frame as measured by me, then using this ux, uy, uz, I can find out what is u. U square will be equal to ux square plus uy square plus uz square. Using this u, I can calculate gamma u. Okay? I have measured my velocities in my frame of reference, so I know ux, uy, uz. I use this ux, uy, uz to find out u. This u square is ux square plus uy square plus uz square. Okay? Once I know u square, I find out my gamma u. Now, instead of just multiplying m naught by ux, I also multiplied by gamma u. That's the new definition of momentum. Now, similarly for the same particle, if I go to S prime frame of reference, that particular particle will experience, will find out the speed of the particle as u prime. And therefore, if that particular person has to define the momentum in his or her frame of reference, okay, he would use these ux prime, uy prime, uz prime to calculate u prime square. Using u prime square, he would calculate gamma u prime. Then take ux prime, multiply by m naught, and also multiply by gamma u prime. That's the way we define the momentum in relativity. Now the second statement which I make, which again I am not proving here, I mean requires a little bit more of time to do. In classical mechanics, as just now I said, we define processes which are elastic and inelastic processes, you know, like elastic collision, inelastic collision, as to be more specific. Elastic collisions are those in which energy and momentum both are conserved, and the example which I gave you was a totally inelastic process, totally inelastic collision in which only momentum was conserved, energy is not conserved. Unfortunately, relativity does not distinguish between any such processes. There is no process in which only momentum is conserved. Momentum and energy both have to be conserved. That's what I said. Only momentum energy momentum conservation. Does the new definition of momentum guarantee universality of conservation of momentum? It's still not enough. It can be shown that if you want the conservation processes to be valid over all the frame of reference, not only momentum, but energy must also be conserved. And what energy should be conserved was a new definition of energy, not the classical energy. So what Einstein did, defined a new form of momentum and a new form of energy. And once you define momentum and energy in the new form, then any process, even a completely inelastic collision, both energy and momentum have to be conserved. There is no process in which momentum and energy, either momentum is conserved or energy is conserved. Okay, every process, both momentum and energy have to be conserved. So the answer is no, we need to conserve energy also in contrast with the classical mechanics. And this is the new definition of energy, which as all of you know, I mean almost the whole world knows, those people who are not even physicists know. Einstein is known as E is equal to mc square. It's a new definition of energy that you have to define. If you define energy in this particular fashion, which is also m naught gamma u c square. So if you know the particle velocity in your frame of reference, you can calculate gamma u, take m naught, multiply it by gamma u, multiply by c square. This is the expression for energy. This expression of energy has no classical counterpart. It's a totally new concept of energy. In fact, you can show that if u turns out to be equal to zero, the energy will still be there, which is m naught u square. Because if u is equal to zero, gamma u turns out to be equal to one. And in that case, even if the particle is at rest, the particle will have energy, which is called m naught c square, which generally we call as the rest mass energy. So kinetic energy was only the additional energy that you get in addition to the rest mass energy when the particle starts moving. The new form of the energy does not resemble any classically known form of energy. It's entirely new concept of energy. Energy gain or loss in different form would lead to an increase of mass. This is something which is very, very important. So like in completely inelastic collision, when the energy was lost, okay, in relativity, energy was not lost. Actually, it gained some other form of energy, and that has effectively changed its mass. In fact, mass is related to energy directly. In fact, I mean, if you ask a particle physicist, they will always express the masses of the particle energy, because energy and mass are linked by fundamental constant C square. If you ask a particle physicist, what is the mass of the electron? He will say half MeV, 0.51 MeV. What is the mass of the proton? 938 MeV. See, electron volt is the energy of units of energy. Actually, it means that m naught c square is equal to 0.51 MeV. Mass can be expressed in the units of energy as the two are related through a fundamental constant. Kinetic energy is defined as mc square minus m naught c square. You can show that this energy in the classical limit turns out to be equal to half mu square. So basically, these are our new definitions. P is equal to mu, E is equal to mc square. Kinetic energy is equal to mc square minus m naught c square. And m is this expression, m naught upon under root 1 minus u square by c square. These are the new definitions which one has to take through. Of course, this is the famous energy momentum relationship. See, like in any problem, we have to convert energy into momentum. This is the relationship, e square is equal to p square c square plus m naught square c to the power 4. This is the relationship between kinetic energy and momentum, which in fact can be shown that in classical limit is approximately equal to p square by 2m. I'm sorry, I'm just hurrying through, but these are just mathematics. In fact, these transparencies will be available to you, so you can go through it. So this is my last transparency. In every process, both energy and momentum have to be conserved. In the complete inelastic collision discussed earlier, the rest mass of the final particle will be larger than the sum of the rest masses of the initial particles. Of course, there are certain cases in which there is no internal structure. Then, of course, rest mass of electron will always be rest mass of electron. It can never increase. So energy and momentum both are not conserved. That process will not be possible. I'll give you an example of such process in our later lectures. I think just finish in time. Thank you. Yeah. But you had questions, somebody said?
Yes, sir. Yeah. I am seeing that this is the last session on the relativity. Hmm. I have two questions about this.
You have two?
Two questions.
Yeah.
One question which is not included in this presentation is on twin paradox.
Beg your pardon?
Twin paradox.
See, as I say, I'm avoiding paradoxes at all.
Yeah, basically, so, I'm confused, sir, in this.
So, I have not read it about, and I also don't want to read it, because things that, you know, I mean, I can give you references of books, where they will talk about paradoxes. There is a book by Professor Venkatraman who has been written, which is essentially written on the paradoxes in relativity.
Because they basically want why they are two observations different or same as measured by...
As I said, most of these paradoxes always have something which is sort of hidden there, okay, which is, which sort of avoids the use of correct equations. So I can suggest you book, this is one book by Professor Venkatraman who has written, which essentially talks about the paradoxes in relativity.
Okay, sir.
So you can go through that book, they will describe on all the details.
Second question is that, sir, what is the derivation of rest mass energy m naught c square? Where from this relation comes?
See, this is basically an assumption. Let me put it like that.
Because when we find
let me first paraphrase this particular thing. Yeah. If you want to know why this, there are two questions which I have not answered, which can be answered. If you look, for example, either in this book or you look at my detailed lectures, which I have given you reference from in the NPTEL. See, using the concept of four vectors, okay, it can be shown that if energy is put in this particular form and if momentum is put in this form, this will guarantee the universality of conservation laws. Okay, this particular thing, which actually would have taken another 3-4 lectures, I am totally avoiding it. Okay, using the concept of four masses, you can always define certain quantities which are universal, which will be valid in all the frame of references. Okay, now if you use those particular concepts, you can show that if momentum is defined in this way and energy is defined in this particular way, then conservation laws will be universal. Okay, now you can always argue the questions. One can always argue saying that why not this particular, because all I have said that if it is in this form, it will obey. But I have not said why cannot be any other form which will also be obeyed. For this, which I don't have an answer. Okay, only thing I can say, remember, any theory, any postulate that we do has to be eventually experimentally verifiable. Nowadays, we believe in these expressions because with a lot of those mass defects that we do in nuclear physics, we are able to predict binding energies very correctly. We are able to get fission energy, fusion energy very, very accurately. Okay, therefore, we believe in these laws. If these would not have been experimentally verifiable at any extent, okay, people may not have believed it. So, I am not showing why energy should be written only in this form and not any other form. All I am writing is that if I write in this particular, which also I, by the way, I have not shown it, if energy is written in this particular form and if momentum is written in this form, okay, universality of conservation of law will hold. That's all I am writing.
Yeah, basically the thing is that when we derive the relation E equals to mc square to the students, the student asks when you are using m naught c square already, then what is the significance of deriving the E equals to mc square?
See, one thing which I always specifically mention that I never derived Lorentz law transformation. Okay. I never derived, for example, Schrodinger equation. I never, for example, derived Newton's law of motion. I never derived E is equal to mc square. Okay. All these things have come from a set of arguments. Okay. Why I believe in Newton's laws of motion? Because we have performed a large number of experiments that they seem to be obeyed, at least in the classical limit. So therefore, we believe in Newton's laws of motion. Okay, relativity, Lorentz transformation, why do I believe it? Because now we have many experiments which can be explained only if the Lorentz transformation is valid. Therefore, I believe it. I have never derived it. So, the use of the word derived, I always want to avoid. I am never deriving it. I am just giving a set of arguments. Okay, why this is the way it should be. If it is done this way, this will obey this property. But you can always come out with an alternate way saying that, no, this is not correct. If I define energy in something different way, momentum in something different way, it's still universality will hold good. Okay? Then where do I test whether this is correct or that correct? On the experiments.
Right. Thank you.
Yeah.
In a collision is one where two particles collide and
if there are same masses, then there is no resultant velocity. In many cases, it is lost as heat and in other form. So if all the energy is lost as heat, then how come the rest mass of the final particle will be larger?
Okay. See, when I am talking of these particular collisions, at that time I have not assumed that loss of energy has taken place in any other matter. Okay. What I am saying that if there is no other loss, then this particular rest mass will become this much. Now, if it becomes cold, okay, then rest mass will go down. If some certain amount of sound energy has gone down, the rest mass will go down. Because all form of energy is contained in its rest mass energy. Okay? So, if a particle has become hot, its rest mass goes up. The particle has become cool, the rest mass comes down. So it's just the variation of rest mass. The only problem which is there, which that's what I wanted to point out, which probably I will discuss when I discuss Compton effect. If these two particles happen to be electron, then you cannot say that electron has a rest mass different from what is the standard particle, standard electron. See, a bigger particle which can get heated, then I can always talk that rest mass has gone up because it has become hot. But if what happens to electrons, if it becomes hot, it will only start moving. So there cannot be any other form of energy. Okay. So in that particular cases, if a conservation of energy and momentum is not violated, that particular process will not take place. For example, one example which we always give, that if there is an electron and is a photon is incident, this electron can never absorb this photon. So a free electron can never give you what you call as a photoelectric effect. A photon can never be absorbed by an electron because you cannot conserve both energy and momentum simultaneously. Okay, so that process will not be possible.
Only energy transfer will be there, they are collided.
No, it will not possible because energy, not only energy, momentum also has to be conserved. See, photon has a momentum of h nu upon c, so that also should be conserved. Okay, and you can show that if you make energy conserved, momentum will go away.
Will it hit the electron?
So it means it's not possible. The electron will never be able to absorb.
You need to bring a third particle.
Yeah, so in fact, in photoelectric effect, this electron is always bound. Only for bound electrons it's possible to see.
That till Lorentz transformation, length contraction, time dilation, and velocity addition, second postulate of relativity was only taken care of, not the first postulate.
That's it.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.